Are you ready? Are you? Now, I'm going to pick on you guys since you're right here on the bottom floor here, okay? How many of you here are ready to learn about body language? Woo! Great. Again, my name is Susan Constantine. I'm a body language expert, and today you're going to learn about what is the body language of today's women leaders. But before we start, all of you have got to be sworn in. So raise your right hand and repeat after me. I solemnly swear to tell the truth.
I solemnly swear to tell
the truth. The whole truth.
The whole truth.
Nothing but the truth.
Nothing but
the truth. So help me God. Keep your hands up and look at your partner next to you. Notice if your fingers are open or they're closed. Is the wrist bent backwards or is it slightly coming forward? All right, you can put your hands down. So I'm going to tell you whether the person next to you is going to tell you the truth or they're going to lie to you. Alrighty, the person with their hand up like this, with their fingers wide open, they will tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth. Woo! But they're going to give you so much information, we don't need to hear it all. The person with their hand open like this, fingers together, now everybody gets quiet here. They will also tell the truth and nothing but the truth. But, okay, you have to pull every single word out of them because they won't give it to you freely. The person with their hand like this, slightly coming forward, this person will also tell you the truth. But this is the person that's going to go along with a pack. So if you have a friend that you want to convince really easily, she's an easy target. The person with their hand like this and their wrist bent back, shame, shame on you. You're the one that will lie to get yourself out of some hot water if you need to. Okay, well, a lot of you might be wondering, you know, how does one become a body language expert? So I'm going to share with you a little story, kind of changing the tone a little bit, and then we're going to pick it back up again. So, you know, as I was talking to Vikai, and she says, you know, you really need to share this story. Well, little did I know that my path, just like your path, was already set in motion years before. So when I was 15 years old, I was staying at a girlfriend's house, and my mother just didn't like the neighborhood too much. And I was asked to spend the night and to babysit with her. So my mom goes, you know, that neighborhood is kind of iffy. I feel a little uncomfortable you being over there. And what do we usually say to our mothers? Oh, Mom, really? You know, what's there to be worried about? So we went over there, and we babysat, and I to this little boy that was 4 years old. And it was a single mother living in a duplex. And the craziest thing was, my friend Vicky, who was the strongest Baptist Christian in the world, okay? And she says to me, when we're over there babysitting, she says, what would you do if someone came in this and broke in this house and they killed us? Okay, this was not funny, all right? I was like, I knew there was a reason why my mom told me not to come here, right? So I was scared to death. She says, what would you do? Would you go to heaven? And I was about to tell her just about anything she needed to hear because I just really wanted to go home. I was feeling homesick at that time. Well, nothing really happened that day. A couple weeks later, my girlfriend calls me again, and she says, you want to come over and babysit with me again? So I says, sure. So we did. So I went over to her house. And about a half an hour before we were supposed to be babysitting, we get a phone call that not to bother coming over because her date stood her up. So as I'm sitting out on the porch, now we am staying overnight, and it's during dusk time. We're out there just kind of hanging out during the summertime. And we had nothing else to do because now we're not babysitting. And back then, we were paid like about 50 cents per hour in babysitting, by the way. We didn't get much, okay? So I saw this van pull up, and this van pulled up directly in front of my girlfriend's house, and I remember distinctly what was written on that van. It was a carpet place, and I could tell you exactly what those letters looked like, what the van looked like. And the gentleman got out, well, I don't call him a gentleman, but he got out of the car, and as he got out of the car, he started walking down the street, looking into other cars. I'm going, something's not right here. Something's not right. So shortly after, oh gosh, probably about a half an hour goes by, somebody comes running out between my girlfriend's house and house next door, and it was that guy who pulled the van up, and he stopped and he looked right at me. He had something in his hand, opened the back of his van, threw it in there, and he got in the car and he sped off. So momentarily, I saw all of a sudden police cars, helicopters, police dogs, and police officers walking between the went through the neighborhood and said, "Did you kids see anything?" I said, "I did. I saw this guy." And I did give this description. He had blonde curly hair. He had jeans on. He had a t-shirt, and this is what it said on it. In the van, it was white, and it had red letters on it. And he stopped at the end of the van, and he looked at me, and I got a really good description of him. And I said, "What happened?" He says, "A woman was just murdered around the corner. The lady I was going to be babysitting for." So, you know, some things happen in life that you don't really plan on. And that's a true story. So when I became a body language expert, I realized that I was able to pick up subtle clues much easier than other people. So that's why I decided as time went by, I got a phone call to work with Courtney Love. How many of you know who Courtney Love is? I mean, she girl's a mess, okay? So I had to work with her for 4 days and helping her improve her image and how she was projecting in front of other people and their body language. And she actually ended up winning a trial that she was here in Orlando being accused of battering somebody in the audience. Well, anyway, as time went by, I realized that there is actually something here. I'm also a jury consultant, so I help people detect if somebody's lying to them, whether it's a witness or a suspect in high-profile cases. A lot of you have probably, of course, heard the Casey Anthony, the Jody Arias, the George Zimmerman. The list goes on and on and on. So I'm often used in the media to read people. And most currently, I'm watching the debates. So we're going to look at today who I think was the winner of this particular debate, and she happens to be a woman. Yes! Okay, are you ready, ladies? Okay. All right, so we know that people make quick judgments, don't they? I mean, especially women, when we meet someone else, we instantly go, "I don't like her. I didn't like her." So we're just like, right? You ask a guy that going, "I don't know. I don't think about that man," right? They just don't. But we as women make very, very quick judgments. So what I would like you to know is that everything that you are projecting on the outside is a direct reflection of how you're feeling about yourself in the inside. You're saying, mm-hmm. Everything you do, whether it's holding your arms or whether it's blinking your eyes rapidly, crossing your legs and creating a barrier, she's kind of harnessing herself in, whether you're stretched out or whether you collapse, it's all about how you think and feel. So we're going to examine that today, okay? Alrighty. So we're going to talk about the body language of a what? Brave woman. Okay. So here's one brave woman right here. We see her. Ursula says, "We don't underestimate the importance of body language." You remember then she's kind of walking out, right? You know, even she knew the importance of body language. Okay, so we know that first impressions speaks louder than words, right? Let's look at this. Let's look at this interaction.
So here's a clip showing the subtle difference between Gordon Brown and Barack Obama. Here they are arriving at number 10, and Look at this lucky policeman gets to shake hands with the President of the United States. Oh, and here comes the Prime Minister of the... No. At least he resisted doing that, to be fair.
I bet he's one of those people that goes in to kiss you on the cheek and ends up weirdly kissing you on the lips. But, oh.
Okay, so the point is, we make an impression. So, you know, the way we shake our hands, the way we look at someone, the way we carry our body language is going to project whether we're being confident or we're dealing with low confidence. So how many of you want high profits, big success, big money, and you want to be able to be successful and be a brave woman? Do you want powerful body language? Yes. Okay. We don't have wimps in this room. So I'm going to show you how you can really rev it up. Here we go. All right, so we know that female leaders are champions, right? We wouldn't be here if we didn't think we were a champion. The greatest strength we have is our warmth. Oftentimes, women, when we get into the field, especially with men, what do? We want to be a little tougher, right? And we want to almost become more masculine-like. What I'm sharing with you, ladies, is celebrate your femininity. Celebrate you're a woman. You have so much power within you being a female. So let's not use, you know, masculine body language or very aggressive handshakes or dressing androgynously because that doesn't work today. It doesn't. So we need to use our greatest strength, which is our likability, our warmth, and our empathy, and our caring. That's what we're here for on earth. We're nurturers. So in order to gain power and authority and credibility and status, we have to make sure that we are not sending submissive body language. Do you know what that is? What does submissive body language look like to you? I want to hear. What does submissive body language look like to you? Head down. Droopy. Okay, what else? Posture, their posture. Well, I'm sorry? No eye contact. All righty. So here is who I think that won the debate. Yes, Carly, you go, girl. But one thing that I want you to notice, look at the long strides that she's making when she's on stage. She's not taking little baby steps or looking down. She's walking proud, girl. She's walking proud with long strides, and she's got her body language open. She's feeling powerful. And you know what's interesting? Coming out of the gate in a high-stakes situation, like if I'm behind stage and I collapse my body before I walk out here, I'm not expelling that energy. So when you're in a high-stakes situation, you have to expand your body language so that you're able to create more confidence, and we're going to talk about that in a little bit. So we're going to talk about the head tilt. Okay, ladies, we always do this, right? We're always like doing, we're tilting our head. Well, tilting the head is really great, but you also have to remain neutral with your head tilt. So in other words, bring your head straight up, but when you want someone to know that you're listening, now everybody tilt your head slightly. It's not this, okay? And it's not this, and it's not like this. Okay, hi. Okay, it's just tilting the head. This is showing someone that you're an active listener. Women tend to overdo this. We tend to keep our head to the side, and we start bobbing our head, just like that little dog that sits in the back of your car, that little one that sits in the back of your windshield there, and we just tend to bob our heads. So everyone, take a neutral position and just slightly turn your head. Now just lean forward a little bit. That's an active listening position. That's when people are feeling like that you're into them, that you are listening to what they have to say. So watch Carly. She does this. She'll turn her head, and then she'll go here because she's thinking, One thing that she has to be careful of, because she does do this quite a bit, is not to overdo it. Find a balance. All right, so this is really cool. What we found is that people, when they feel very confident in something that they're presenting, a mission, a product, your services, when they're speaking to a customer or two, and they're speaking in front of a group, they tend to use their dominant hand. How many are right-handed here? Okay, what you'll find is that you will be speaking more from your dominant hand. But if you're in a place of business and you have an opposing viewpoint, you may not know it, but you switch to your non-dominant hand. So what I'd like you to do is really be aware, especially when you're watching the debates, when you can find, they don't even have to say a word. Their viewpoints will change. You'll know when their viewpoints change when they switch hands. So their dominant hand they use when they're speaking about everything they're very confident about, their passion, their mission, and then they'll switch when they don't like the other person. I love watching this, especially when she was battling with Donald Trump. Okay, so what we found is that this is research-based. So they went through all these different presidential candidates that ran for office, and we found that people that were very passionate and they believed in what their mission was, they would use their dominant hand, but they would switch and use their non-dominant hand when they didn't. Does it make sense? Interesting, huh? All righty, the smile. This is what we call a genuine smile. Okay. But there are also other smiles, aren't there? It's like, hi. You know, there's that disingenuous one, is when we run into someone, let's say in the grocery store, or we're out and we're going, hi, how are you? You know, cheek kiss. And we notice that that's not genuine, because what happens is that the mouth on the top is just stretched horizontally. There's no movement up, even though the bottom lip goes down. The top lip stays more horizontal, and you don't see the brightness in the eyes. So it's important to smile. But one thing that I want to also share with you, and if you notice Carly, did she smile a lot in the debate? No. Because, unfortunately, if we smile a lot, it diminishes our power and our authority. So you have to remain neutral. That doesn't mean stone-faced, no affect. You remain soft and neutral. You tilt the head. You bob it two or three times that you understand what the other person is saying. Every now and then, you smile, but you don't smile a lot. Powerful leaders smile less. And there's a lot to be said about that, because they're just taken more seriously. And I think that's one of the things where Sarah Palin had a tough time, because she was smiling a lot, and she was kind of quirky and that sort of thing, which I actually liked about her, but she was really scrutinized because of that. So we now know, too, that you need to keep a neutral face. And here's the other one. I'd like all of you to take your hands and do palms up. All right. When you're talking, you want to use palms up. Now I want you to switch and do palms down. Okay. All right, put your hands down. The difference between the two is when you're talking, palms up, this is for collaboration, for feedback, this is for honesty, this is for connectiveness. When then now, you will want to switch when you say, this is what our plan is. You can't do it. This is what our plan is. Dominant hand down when you're making a directive, palms up when you're wanting feedback. Is this cool stuff? Simple, isn't it? But we don't even realize that what we're doing, because what we do as women, we sometimes kind of flay our hands around. Our body language should mirror the words that we're speaking. This is what we're doing. We have three different proposals we want to talk to. I'd like to have your feedback on it, and also to Mrs. So-and-so. So here's our plan. Make sense? All righty. Change it up. Now we're going to look at the body. We're going to remain expansive. There's a lot of research on how we actually position our body. And we're going to talk about how it actually to increase your testosterone level just by changing your body position. So that doesn't mean that you're going to grow hair on your face, by the way. All right? So the body, you're going to want to remain open and expansive. And where it says stay within your frame, when you're speaking, one thing that I have to share with you, President Obama is a phenomenal body language expert in speaking. Because when he speaks, he always speaks within his frame. What I mean by that is, in order to appear more confident and competent, you want to remain your body language within your frame, between your shoulders and your hips. keeping your hands about waist level. So you move out, you move in, this is how you're using it. You're using your hand gestures, you're making a point, you're staying within your frame. Now, as a speaker, and if you're doing presentations, I can expand my hands as a speaker wide enough to hug all of you. But if I'm doing a press conference or if I'm meeting with a client one-on-one, I am not going to expand my body language out beyond my frame. Make sense? All right. So with that being said, we want to expand our body language. We want to open it up. We don't want to close it up like a fig leaf. We want to stay open. So basically, all you have to do is just take one step to the side and be out here. This is positive, powerful body language. Okay. So talked about avoid over-smiling, maintaining a neutral expression, avoid smirking. Now, we saw a lot of the smirking with what? Rant? We saw a lot of this in the public and in the debates. We saw Bush smirking a lot. You know, it's interesting. People don't realize that the eyes to the person that is watching you is like a camera lens. It picks up every little movement you make, good or bad, positive or negative. We talked about the head nods. In agreement, it's three times. You tilt your head. You give about 70 to 80% eye contact. So we don't want to do the stalker eyes. We just want to look at someone in the eyes, and it's an authentic connection. The other thing is that in order to really read people, you have to get outside of the questions that you decided you're going to come in with. I know you got an agenda. But the greatest thing you could do is just connect. Truly be interested. Tilt your head, not because I said so. Lean forward, not just because I said it, but show that you're interested. This is when you're going to really connect with people. You know, I'm in sales, and it's really easy for me because all you have to do, because I'm selling what I do, right, is just to be authentic. Be yourself. All right, so we now know Amy Cuddy. Has anyone ever seen the TED Talk on the body language? We're going to talk a little bit about that. So what's interesting is that if we change our body language, like if we're not feeling really powerful, if we just expand out, we actually will increase our confidence level rather than closing ourselves in. So we can change if we change our body language, we can actually change our minds. We can change how we're thinking by just changing our body language. You know, there's a great movie that's out that's called Happiness. Have you ever seen that one? No, another one that's called I Am. I would encourage all of you to watch those two movies. I Am, and the other one is called Happiness. Phenomenal documentaries. So again, whatever you're thinking and feeling is going to be shown on the outside. That's just the way it is. We now know for example, I teach facial recognition. You saw the piece that I was on Dr. Phil. The Dr. Phil case was about a girl that was a missing person. He wanted me to be on the show, and he wanted me to analyze some photographs of a child who came missing at 14 years old, and that they thought that they found her at an ATM machine taking some money out. Well, she's known, this person who they saw in the photo also has been known for stealing money and that sort of some fraud stuff. Anyway, I read faces. Everything you feel is seen on your outside of your face. It is the number one most predictable and accurate indicator of what somebody's thinking. If you can hone in on reading faces, you can use that strategically in any sort of situation, social or business situation. So on the Dr. Phil case, I was there reading the body language and the facial expressions of these photos and was able to determine that the person that was at the ATM machine was most likely 80% that was actually her. Just by looking at her facial expressions and seeing multiple photos when she was younger and then comparing them to the current photos, just even structurally on her face, it was the same person. This is exciting because I get to break cases open. What a rewarding job that is. I love it. Alrighty, so I am brave power posing. We're going to talk about that. We know that when we're confident, we expand. Every primal does this. Anything in the world. We even think of a flower. What happens when it starts to bud? It opens up and it says, I'm alive. I'm here. I am brave. Look at how beautiful I am. Everything in nature opens up when it feels good about itself. And what happens when it doesn't? It shuts right down, doesn't it? We collapse. So here's another one. Here we go. We're looking at this again. You know, a peacock. I love watching peacocks. You know, especially the male peacock. And he goes, whoosh, does that. And he starts strutting his stuff around going, look at me. Look at me, baby. I look good, don't I? Mm-hmm. Look at these feathers. I'll tell you what. You know, they just tend to do that. But when we don't feel confident, this is what happens. We start to contract our bodies. We worry. We put our hands on our, you know, we're just collapsing. So when you're feeling like this, examine your own self and notice what your body language is saying and make the appropriate adjustments. And you can get yourself out of that depression or sadness or lack of feeling of power, or you're feeling insecure, because that's one thing that women we tend to go through, that lack of confidence. All right, so here's when Carly's not feeling very confident. This is an older picture. See her hand over wrist? Yeah, very guarded, creating a barrier. This is what we call the fig leaf position. If I were to stand next to Carly, and she was in this position, and I just kind of pushed her shoulder back, she would probably take a step back and almost fall over. But if I were to stand on stage with her as she was walking out, powerful, and she stood there, and I pushed her shoulders, I bet she's going to be like a tank. So you need to, when you're in those situations where you don't feel so powerful, expand your body language and plant yourself. So this is low authority. This is vulnerable and guarded. When someone sees you like this, they're assuming that there is no confidence going on here. So be aware of that. All right, so I did this piece here. This was in Women's Day. And I love doing this stuff because, in fact, I also do the National Choir. And I just did a piece on them, on Michael Douglas and Kathleen Zeta-Jones at the U.S. Open, because there's trouble in that marriage. And I said, after I looked at the photographs, I go, I don't like her. I called her the torturist. She just tortures this poor guy. So I get to read Brad Pitt and Angel Lee, and I get to read Katy Perry and all of them, and, you know, pretty much all the celebrities that are hot and popping. I get a phone call saying, hey, would you look at these photos? You know, so it's a lot of fun because it's always one-sided. I get to tell them, everybody else, what they're saying, but nobody comes back and says anything to me. I love it. Okay, so anyway, we're going to talk about how to gain more confidence. All right, this is so cool. This guy is, when we feel powerful and we won, what do? I want you to just imagine the most exciting time in your life where everything that day went great. And you walked away and you're going, yeah. Oh, I got it. Girl, I got it. What do we do with our hands? I want to see it. Yes. Right. Don't we go, yes, victory. Interestingly, this gentleman here is blind. He didn't know that when people felt victorious, that they put their hands up and they put their chin up. Victory. No one told him because he couldn't see it. The body responds to how you feel. Victorious. So there's actually research behind it. We found that when Amy Cuddy did some research on checking the saliva, did a saliva test on the hormones of people in different social situations. So in a high-stakes situation where there was a lot at risk, it could be you're going for a big job, you're going to meet a client for the first time, you're going for a promotion, something's got to be at stake. When you took on what we called one of three power poses, you were able to increase your testosterone level, which is your confidence, by 25%. 25%. But we also found that during that time, if you were to contract your body language during those high-stakes social situations, you decreased your testosterone and increased your cortisol, which is your female hormone, by 25%, losing massive power. So just in a power pose, you can make some big, just some little tweaks, you can make some big changes. So what I'd like all of you to do is I want you to stand up. And the first thing I want you to do is I want all of you to give me your greatest superwoman pose you've ever done. Go do it now. I want to see the Superman pose. Yes, I'm powerful. Shoulders back, chin up, chest out. I am powerful. I want to hear, I am powerful.
I am
brave. I am successful. Give me the victory sign. Woo! Take a seat. How many of you felt energy when we did that? It works, ladies. It got the adrenaline going. It got you excited. So when you're in those situations, I want you to take on that power pose. I want you to stand mighty and proud as a woman. I want you to put that chin up, and I want you to tell yourself, I am amazing. I am strong. I am one of a kind. And I was made unique. Don't change who you are. Be yourself. Be authentic. And you will become more successful than you ever dreamed in your entire life. But you've got to change the way you think to change your outcome. Let's watch Katy Perry. Fearless and brave.
Louder!
you so much, ladies. Be fearless, be brave, and roar to the top. Again, my name is Susan Constantine, and I was your presenter today, and I am the body language expert. Thank you until again.
Thank you, Susan. Awesome, awesome message. Lots of activity. Good for after lunch. Got our workout in, right? So, Susan, since you are a body language expert, I want to do a Q&A, but I actually want to get down here with the audience and interact. Yep, let's walk this way. We're coming for you, ladies. Get ready. So, Susan, one thing that I really love that you said is about, you know, sometimes the way that we dress as women, we want to maybe cover up for a job interview. I mean, you know, dress professionally, but maybe pick the suit instead of the dress, yes. Right? So why do we do that to ourselves? And why is it so important to, again, be authentic, be true to yourself? If you feel more confident, more comfortable wearing the dress than the suit, do that, right? So how can women really kind of feel empowered and do that in the professional setting?
Well, the first thing is to know it's acceptable. So I think a lot of times we don't think that that's acceptable. We're thinking that we have to dress like a guy or wear a suit that looks like, you know, the dark suit every day with a white blouse. And that looks wonderful, and there is nothing wrong with that. And I would encourage, if that's your look, then you need to wear that. But what I'm sharing with you is that you could wear a dress. In fact, a lot of you I know watch the news, right? How often, other than looking at Greta Van Susteren, do you see women in a suit? By the way, I don't like Greta. But anyway, met her, don't like her. Not a nice lady. Anyway, with that being said, look at all the other newscasters. What are they wearing? Sleeveless tops, but they're always covered in hair. So they look professional, they look classy, and they're still looking feminine. So I would say, you know, be your authentic self, and the most important thing is to dress for your body type.
Oh, that is so important. All right, let's make our way over here. I want to do a little bit of an exercise. So why don't we do this, Susan? Let's say we are all walking into a job interview,
yes.
Okay, and you're wearing your dress, you're feeling, you know, great, and you are being interviewed by a man, and you want this man to take you seriously. You may be a young woman, you know, good looking, and you want to make sure that he is only paying attention to what's coming out of your mouth and nothing else. Okay, so walk us through posture, how we should sit.
Okay, so posturing, what we are not going to do is this. Okay, we're not going to be doing the shimmy. We don't need to be doing the shimmy at that point, okay? I think a woman, when she walks in, she should make eye contact to where she's going and not look down. What women tend to do is they do this. So follow them. So what are they already doing? They're decreasing what? Yes. So when you lift your head up and you're walking forward, right, you already know where you're going to go. See, we're going to go down this hall and we're going to go to the left. So you're going to look more powerful, longer strides, shoulders back, chin up slightly, making eye contact, staying within the corner of the nose on up. And when you look at them, don't smile. Be cordial. Be powerful. But don't look angry, because women, we can look a little angry sometimes, you know? If you have a problem with that, there's a great antidote. And you know what that is? Botox. Works every time.
Awesome. Do you ladies have any questions? I know that this is a very important topic to all of us, really, right? Not just in a professional setting, but just in your everyday life. Even when you're walking through the mall, the way that you walk, the way that you, you know, kind of carry yourself, that all says something about you. So do you have any questions for Susan? Awesome.
Thank you. How do you carry yourself powerfully and giving off that confidence without coming off as pompous in an interview?
Well, a really good thing is not to look smug like Trump does. Okay? We don't want to be pursing our lips. We don't want to be having our head up so high that we look arrogant and aloof. We want to keep our eyes warm. Our greatest attribute is what? Warmth. Connectiveness. That's who we are as women. If we can connect into the eyes, we've connected into their soul. So that's the key. Practice on what we call eye contact gazing. there you can do some exploring and do some eye contact gazing exercises, meaning that's you practice with a friend and you look at them just in the eyes for about 30 seconds, and you'll be surprised. When you allow yourself just to get connected in the eyes, you can literally see the windows, the souls of their heart. So is that answer your question? Is there another one? It's just our stride. The other thing is, too, is that we want to, what we call, I call this the belly button rule, okay? And that is that we want to point our belly button when we're with someone in their direction, so we're parallel. When we shift or we give them the cold shoulder, we're basically saying that we want to exit that direction. So you want to not necessarily square off, but you do want to be straight in front of them, making good eye contact. Yes.
Ladies, any other questions for Susan?
How did you know that you wanted to do or learn about body language, and who were your mentors as you were growing up?
That's wonderful. Well, I'm going to answer that question as far as the mentor first. The mentor is the entrepreneur part, because I believe that all of us possess gifts. Multiple gifts. And we're not defined of just doing one thing in our lives. We have multiple talents. My mentor was my mother. And the reason why my mother was a mentor to me is because she really beat all the odds. She was an 11th grade graduate. She never finished high school. But she had a passion and a vision to helping people in need. And everyone kind of looked at her and kind of scoffed at her and said she can't do what she wanted to do. She wanted to open up an organization for people that were going through personal tragedies. But she didn't have any money. So she relied on, you know, prayer and so forth, that she says, you know, I just know that if this is what I'm supposed to do, you're going to guide the way. That's what happened to me. If this is the way you want me to go, you're going to open those doors for me. Well, little did I know that my mother was up for what would they call the Jefferson Award. There were 46,000 people in the United States that were up for nomination for one of the top philanthropists in this country. My mother was one of them. She's the founder of the Mustard Seed of Central Florida. So she is my mentor. As far as how I knew to go in this direction, my business found me. People had the need. They wanted to know how to be able to be more accurate in reading other people. And I was really tired of all the baloney. People were saying, oh, if you scratch your face here and you must be lying, or if you tap your nose, you're lying. A lot of it wasn't really true. So because I was a jury consultant, I was the eyes and ears of the attorney assessing the credibility of potential jurors and witnesses. One area that I was weak in was reading people, because I didn't have the skills. So I went out and got them. I have 4 certifications in investigations and interrogations, also 2 in interrogative statement analysis, and I also have been a core trainer with the Institute of Analytic Interviewing, and I've also trained with Dr. Paul Ekman, Dr. Matsumoto. Dr. Ekman is the one who was a consultant for the program called Lie to Me, reading facial expressions. So with that being said, I was showing up at the courthouse, and I was called to work on the Casey Anthony to analyze for the TV stations. And before you knew it, I was just exploded. I was on every major TV show. I did over 400 national appearances just on that case alone. So I was able to give my analysis based on scientific data that I've collected and knowing exactly and precisely what people were thinking and feeling. And then I realized, wow, people really need this. And then I was asked to speak here. And then I was asked to speak there. And here I am today. So the greatest thing that I can share with you ladies is that, which is I'm just really passionate about, and that is that all of us have gifts. We have talents you don't even realize that you can do. And you can take that talent and be self-employed, entrepreneur, and never have to worry about being fired or let off from your job. Vote for me.
All right, let's give it up for Susan Constantine.